Hi guys, Hengist here from House of Hengist Comics, and a big welcome back to the channel, and I hope you're doing well. Today we're back in Norway on the front line, this time on a mountain, and the episode's called A Mountain to Climb. First, the news, and this time it's a German article talking about the airlift, or the change of military operations towards Narvik. As this operational map suggests, there have been really effectively three phases to this. Now, Narvik is really, and Winston Churchill was big on this, it's all about not the oil, but the ore. And the ore works at Narvik were considered to be critical by Allied forces and for the Germans. At Narvik, we've already got Allies landing and they're beginning to surround Narvik in itself. In the meantime, whilst they are unloading tanks, we've also got basically in the north, following their successful battle of Gebirgsjäger and Kriegsmarine, have fallen back to Narvik to better, stronger positions. I'd like to now quickly talk about the battle maps and symbols and some of the influence that helps us sort of decipher what's going on. Sam does a magnificent job in trying to interpret this. And here are some of the maps. And what I want you to be looking at is obviously the operational detail. But if you start looking at these contourings, you can just see, and also the fact that many are actual of these actions in the south are sort of by water or fjords on very, very difficult ground. And today we're going to try and simulate that in itself. So, you know, bear with us on this. Well, critical in this is how we interpret and represent and simulate the terrain. It is really, really difficult ground. As those maps indicated, narrow roads by large courses of water, a lot of snow, very steep slopes. Ideal country for the Gebirgsjäger and mountaineers, but not for regular troops. As some of these pictures sort of indicate, you're looking at some real complications, and that's just a picture there of the slope that we've built up. The Gebirgsjäger were highly adaptive and could lift cranes and things like that, but it's very difficult to manoeuvre in these conditions. So we use scree to represent inaccessible areas, which only mountaineers can go in, and they can't double through it, but they can go into it. And that's critical in this game that's coming up. Another factor that is really important is that forests and woods are area terrain, so you've only got 6 inches of visibility in these, and that makes a crucial difference. We're again employing the double concealed, so when direct fire is made, you've got all these issues concerning re-rolling failed saves if you've got two elements of concealment. Okay, let's now look at the British forces for today's battle. This concerns the Green Howards Regiment. And what we've got is a standard company with 4 platoons with 2 3-inch mortars in the headquarters section. As you can see here, there's a photo of the mortar being brought into action with effectively 2 rounds there. Now, what they also had, and these are Firestorm units which were allocated by HQ, are the 25mm Hotchkiss, which basically was used quite early on because they didn't have enough 2-pounders anti-tank guns seen here. And also the 37mm Bofors anti-aircraft gun, which also doubled effectively against tanks. The German forces, however, with their familiar Edelweiss, have selected, rather than the Panzers, they've gone with the infantry, and they've gone with the Gebirgsjäger, as you can see, fully equipped for these conditions, ready with ropes, tackle, and also a huge amount of mountaineering experience, having trained in the Tyrol and places like that. They've got their 75mm artillery pieces, Kradschützen small platoon from the Panzer Force, and a small platoons of Panzer Grenadiers, as we can see here. They've also got, in addition to this, a Firestorm Air, 7 dice, and artillery. Well, what's all the mission about today? Well, again, we're after, basically, this is a relief effort on Trondheim, as you can see at the north, and we're at a place called Otta. Now, this action actually took place with the Green Howards, and you can see the terrain here. So, funnily enough, we're not too far off what happened historically. They have a roadblock and 1 ambush, and will deploy first. And they've decided, effectively, to secure 1 objective, and the Germans have placed the other. They've placed 1 on the road, the Germans obviously have placed 1 on the mountain. So let's take a better look at that deployment now. You've got the Germans basically looking to attack predominantly down the road and at the mountain, so the Allies aren't too sure. Here we can see a medic. They've got to their right the 25mm Hotchkiss, and they've got two platoons of infantry dug in on top of the hill. So they've got three platoons down, one on the road, two on the hills, with the Bofors, as we've just seen there, also on the mountainside. Now the German forces have made a Kampf group. They've stripped off their two headquarter machine guns, taken about eight men from each platoon. They've only got two platoons, plus sort of mortars, their 75mm mountain guns, as you can see here. And they've also got in support, obviously, the Kradschützen, as you can see here, and also the armoured cars and their own PAK-36 guns, which fire HE, which, of course, the 25mm Hotchkiss doesn't, and that was quite important. Obviously, the Gebirgsjäger are looking to move straight up when they've got the opportunity to do so. Here we see, although they're 38 mils, they're representing 36. And well, let's get straight into the action now, because it's really interesting. Well, this game really all hinges on basically a pincer attack, and it was well executed by the Germans. What you're going to see here is they move straight up with the recon elements to get as far forward as possible. Recon is really critical in this game as well. They pushed forward, basically trying to prevent this ambush and push that ambush back. They're also moving up onto the area terrain. The scouts lead the way, preventing the ambush and also trying to get the rest of their troops up. Now, the British are pretty ignorant on the top of this mountain of what's going on because they can't see anything and their scouts are positioned somewhere else. So they don't really see what's coming, and basically it's two platoons with the scouts that are moving straight up this hill line. Meanwhile, in the valley, what you've got effectively is the more mechanized elements moving forward to hold this position. They use their artillery and open up immediately with the off-table artillery, which does a devastating salvo and blows one of the Bofors straight out of its pits. This is a disaster, really, for the Green Howards, as the Kampfgruppe leader, which is the 2IC, leads his men forward to get into a firing position. The half-tracks hunt down the sniper, which has been positioned a little bit too far forward, and basically drive him off. Whilst the British immediately react once they see where the enemy are moving to and start to prevent themselves from being flanked. As you can see, the Germans are making use of the scree and moving up to a position where they can sort of make a mass assault. There's very little shooting in this because of the double conceal, very few casualties through shooting. What happens here on this hill is a bloodbath. Basically, assaults are launched, and as you can see those logs, that's the objective they're trying to secure and make sure there's a 4-inch bubble. They immediately get air support. This comes in, combined with the 75mm guns, that basically it blows the second gun out, and that platoon is effectively out of the game. They're immobile and they can't move. The platoon, I think it's 3rd platoon down on the road, basically get pinned. And assaults now start and continue on this hill. It's back and forth, bayonet really, action. And casualties start to mount. The British launch a brilliant counter-attack and sort of press the Gebirgsjäger back as their 2nd platoon moves up to try and drive off the scouts as well. But the Germans basically have inflicted more damage and decide to withdraw into the rocks. They've reached the summit. And they're now looking around, basically measuring their time, getting their forces together. Casualties are pretty bad indeed, as you can see from this shot here. It's all basically about whether or not they can actually hold them. And he makes the decision to the Allied player to put the 4th platoon on that hill and try and stop the Gebirgsjäger. But the Gebirgsjäger are in these rocks. They've got bulletproof cover. They can't be assaulted into it. And they're just biding their time. And what they proceed to do next is basically observe when the moment is right. They're conducting a lot of tactical small moves. They keep out of 6 inches. They're being very, very astute in how they attack. And in fact, the German commander played an extremely good game. However, the two British mortars that were in the woodline have to move to the edge to fire. And they, during this game, take so much fire, but still managed to respond. Meanwhile, the first assaults begin in the valley. This is led again by the Kampfgruppe, which launch forward and assault. The unit that they've been attacking has been suppressed. I mean, it has 3 pin markers. It can't fire or counterattack. And so it's very vulnerable. And on the mountain, the Gebirgsjäger suddenly launch their next assault. And they destroy the 2nd Green Howards. They've taken about 40% casualties in the process. And effectively, the first and second platoon of the Green Howards have been destroyed. Meanwhile, those plucky little company mortars are firing, and they're under intense fire all over the place from both mortars and the 75mm guns. But they do finally range in and blow four men out of a mortar pit, causing some consternation for the German commander. But it's artillery off table which is pounding this position on the road, and an assault goes in, and they manage to basically inflict some damage and are starting to drive the British back. In fact, it's looking very, very bleak. The gunners manage to repel a breakthrough assault, but they in turn start to feel very, very threatened. They've got only rifles to defend themselves as artillery is ranging in all round them down on this road and near the stream. Up on the hill, the close quarter battle continues as the 4th Platoon launches an assault, and in desperate, desperate fighting continues. Meanwhile, basically what you've got is effectively those mortars still firing, and they've suppressed the battery, but ultimately the Gebs manage to get in, and basically they catch one infantry stand basically as it's just on the hill edge line, pin that, and the Germans launch a desperate counter-attack because they can from the rocks, and the British assault is repulsed. And they're pushed back and ultimately broken. That means everything on the hill has been basically destroyed or broken. The Panzer Grenadiers now drive in, effectively dismounting and launch an assault into the poor suppressed 3rd Platoon. They're under so much withering fire from the half-tracks, the Kradschützen have dismounted. The Green Howards 3rd Platoon is wiped out effectively to a man. And the 1IC goes down with him. They just couldn't unpin in that situation. They had so many dice rolls. And ultimately, company morale goes and the whole company breaks. There was so much that happened in this company, in this battle, but the casualties were very heavy. I would say about 40 to 45% for the Gebirgsjäger, who were at so many points nearly broken by motivation tests, but just rolled so very, very well. They look tired, they look exhausted, they got to the top of that mountain. It was a brilliant battle fought by the German commander. I mean, absolutely brilliant, the best I've ever seen him play. Well, what this battle's really shown is, although the Green Howards have effectively been destroyed, it's platoons destroyed that really have to be brought back with victory points. But it's demonstrated that without support weapons, and especially in the south without artillery, there's very little you can do to stop sort of combined forces. And combined arms, when it's tanks, infantry and lots of artillery assets, really makes the Germans very powerful in Norway. And we've learned a lot from this. I mean, we should never forget the fallen. I mean, these pictures from Otta suggest a very sad part of our history and loss of human life. I mean, the Gebirgsjäger were relatively well known for being very honourable, and the cemetery at the Green Howards here that we can see sort of depicts basically the number of fallen. I don't know how many they actually fell around Otta, but it's very interesting in its own right. Obviously, if you like our work, please continue to support us. I know we do a very different narrative side, but we're very interested in relating the history as well, so that people get a better understanding of what operations occurred. There's loads coming up, including the Fallschirmjäger, hopefully being flown in to try and relieve a beleaguered Narvik. We've got naval action and a lot more coming up, including some small micro games as well. So stay tuned for more from Norway. And from me, best wishes, and from the crew. And once again, carry on wargaming and enjoy your day. It's over and out from me. Bye for now.